title was an article that caught my attention. The title of the article read, Geigenbauer ist für mich wie Beten. Geigenbauer ist für mich wie Beten. Crafting violins is like prayer for me, by Martin Schleske. I know Martin Schleske, and he is standing here in his workshop making and shaping and forming, crafting, I think is the word, the violin. And he's really one of the best violin makers in the world today. They compared a Stradivari with a Schleske. That's how good he is in making violins. But he's also a Christian. A Christian who makes these violins. And he is interviewed by someone in the Stuttgart Zeitung, and he says again what his two books have already said. A musician without an instrument remains silent. If we had here our two guitar players and Cora who plays the piano, and the instruments weren't here, you would just be stuck. You couldn't play. You couldn't make music. He says, therefore, God is looking for instruments which he can play. And he cannot play on instruments that are not tuned. That's just like if we would start playing and you would hear that both guitars were not tuned with the piano, you would say, wait a minute, stop. They have to get tuned before we can hear the music. God can't play on our lives as instruments if we're not tuned properly. He cannot play on a person, an instrument, if you will, who has a bitter tune. In this interview, the journalist asked him if he ever doubted God. And he responds by saying, yes, I lost my faith. In my last prayer to God, I said, here, God, you have my faith. I am not doing anything more. Ich mache jetzt nichts mehr. And then the journalist asked, and well, then what? Und dann? Asked the journalist. Martin replies, it lasted 8 months until something happened. I was standing at a bus stop, and I was suddenly aware of a voice. It was not a thought, but an inspiration of a listening heart. And the journalist asked, and what did you hear? Martin gibt acht, dass du mich lieb hast. Ich kümmere mich deinen Glauben. Martin, pay attention that you love me, and I will take care of your faith. Martin goes on to say, I had tried to take care of my faith, but that is not possible. In this lies the original question, in which way will I show my love for God and this life around me? We are responsible for that. Afterwards, my faith simply exploded. I'm going to read this paragraph also in German. Ich hatte mich meinen Glauben kümmern wollen, aber das ist nicht möglich. Darin liegt für mich die Urfrage. Auf welche Art will ich Gott und dem Leben meine Liebe zeigen? Dafür sind wir verantwortlich. Und danach ist mein Glauben regelrecht explodiert. Perhaps this fresh dialogue reveals part of the dialogue we read in John's Gospel today. John chapter 21, verses 12 through 17. John 21, verses 12 through 17. John 21, verses 12 through 17. Now come and have some breakfast, Jesus said. dared to ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Then Jesus served them the bread and the fish. This was the third time Jesus had appeared to his disciples since he had been raised from the dead. After breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," Peter replied, "you know I love you." "Then feed my lambs," Jesus told him. Jesus repeated the question, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord," Peter said, "you know I love you." "Then take care of my sheep," Jesus said. A third time he asked him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep." We know that after all the experiences that the disciples had in Jerusalem, beginning with Palm Sunday, and then going through Good Friday, and spilling over into Easter Sunday morning, the disciples were thoroughly confused about what they had just gone through. They weren't clear, like, "Oh yeah, this is the way it was going to be." They had no idea what it was going to be. Peter had denied Jesus along the way. Judas had committed suicide after his betrayal of Jesus. The disciples had fear. And faith was not necessarily easy to come by. The gospel stories talk about doubt. And even Jesus says to them, "You're really slow to believe." There's nothing automatic about faith. I want you all to know, faith is not automatic. You can't really produce it and say, "Well, I'm going to believe today," and just make yourself go out there and believe. And then feeling as if faith is instantly there. We just can't make that happen. Peter was not acting out of faith, really, when he went fishing in the story right before this portion. It was more like an attempt on his part to say, "Well, I can at least do this. I don't have any faith, or not much faith, but at least I can fish." Have you ever felt that way? "Well, at least I can do this. At least I can go cut down a tree." Or, and I'm looking at my friend. "Or at least I can teach a school class. Or at least I can go to IBM and work on my computer stuff. I at least can do this stuff." So some of the disciples joined Peter in all of this fishing stuff. They went all night fishing. And in the morning, what was the result of their all night fishing? Anybody remember the story? Zero fish. No fish at all in the net. Not one single lousy fish after being out all night. And then in the morning, wouldn't you know it, somebody standing on shore asking, "Do you have any fish?" That comes in Peter's most vulnerable moment, when his empty net shows how empty he is. Someone points out by asking him precisely for what he does not have. "Any fish?" "No," they replied. And then the simple command from the person on shore, "Well, then throw your net on the right-hand side of the ship, your boat, and you'll get some." So what do the disciples do? They throw the net on the other side, and they begin to pull the net in, and what happens? There is so many fish in the net that it nearly begins to break. It's at this point in the story, before we read our text, that the disciple, the text says, who Jesus loved, I thought that was an interesting description. Of course, John loved Jesus back, and he's the writer of this gospel. He said immediately, "That's Jesus." So they all go to shore, and what do they find there? Breakfast. I think that would have been wonderful. You worked all night long, and someone else makes breakfast for you. What a wonderful thing. And some of the fish that they just caught were added onto the coals of fire. Fresh fish and bread with Jesus in the morning on a seashore. Wouldn't that be lovely? I'd like to be there. Wouldn't you? On a nice seashore looking out at the Sea of Galilee, fresh fish, bread, fellowship. Ah, that sounds good. But it says here, after breakfast comes this interesting dialogue. Three times there's a question, and three times there's an answer. Jesus asks Peter three times, "Do you love me?" And Peter always answers, "Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus asks Peter again. And Peter responds, "Lord, you know I love you." And the third time Jesus asks that question, "Peter, do you love me?" Peter, so frustrated, says, "Lord, Lord, you know that I love you." And in response to this expression of Peter, "Lord, you know that I love you," Jesus makes a comment. He says, "Then feed my sheep. Then feed my lambs. Then take care of my sheep." Was Jesus giving Peter, and therefore all of us as disciples, the real path to faith? "In love for me, take care of my sheep. Feed the flock." I was reading a book today. It's a book I've been reading the last week or so. And there was one thing that's in there that I've thought about before. Many of us live as if we're atheists. We're actually practical atheists. We say when we're in church, we believe in God. We even sing songs, we hear the sermon, we pray, we're going to take communion, and that would indicate that we know God. And then tomorrow when you live, how do you live out there in the world? Sometimes we live as practical atheists, as if God wasn't there. When Luke describes a similar story about fishing, before he calls, when he's calling the disciples, he quotes Jesus by saying to Peter, "Now go out where it's deeper and let your nets down to catch some fish." And that was another night when they had spent all night with no fish. And Jesus sends them out again. Their nets are full. Full. A huge catch. And you know what Jesus says to Peter at that point? "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people. You'll be going out there to really take care of people and not take care of fish." Let's bring that, roll that up to this story. What had Peter forgotten, really, a bit, was the call that Jesus had given to him. If you plug in sheep for fish in this story, you realize that in the Bible, sheep means people, and that shepherding, in the biblical sense, means someone is taking care of not sheep that go bah, but of people that say all kinds of stuff. "Follow me, the great shepherd who laid down his life for his sheep, Peter, and you'll need great love to do that." Yeah. Peter, you'll need great love to lay down your life for sheep, no, for people. When Peter turned away from his lack of faith, and that must have bothered Peter, I can imagine. He was there, but he still was not quite sure how to put all this together in himself. That's like us. We don't always know where our faith is. Do you always feel like a powerful saint, full of faith and victory? How many feel that way tonight? I don't even see one hand. How many say, I wish I had that kind of faith? Yeah, we would all be there. We'd all be on that page. Well, Peter's faith developed when he turned away from this sense of lack of faith, turned away from his fishing boats, and turned toward the assignment Jesus gave to him. Love me, Peter, by loving others, by caring for them, by feeding them. And then we see that Peter's faith grows. How do we know that? Well, we find him in the upper room on Pentecost. And then Peter, without any fear, goes out on the street and feeds the people with the word of God. He preaches there the words of forgiveness, that Jesus died and rose again to forgive us. Maybe we can find ourselves in this story. The growth of our faith is a result of loving others in Jesus' name. Letting the love of the Lord flow through you to others will increase your faith, just like Martin Schleske discovered. When he worried more about just loving God and loving the world around him, loving the people around him, his faith exploded. Maybe that's the key for us. If we feel like our faith isn't going anywhere, we might ask ourselves, when was the last time I loved somebody just for Jesus' sake? When was the last time I took care of someone just because Jesus wanted me to love that person? And maybe that's the key when our faith will begin to grow. That's what love does. When we love Jesus, Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep.